Hello, welcome to our webinar. Thanks for spending your Friday afternoon with us. We will get started in just a few minutes. I'd like to let a little bit more time for other people to join us. In the meantime, if you do have any questions, you can go ahead and use the question and answer box at the bottom, and then we will try to get to them at the end. And my name is Julie. I am the onboarding specialist and marketing coordinator with Shaw Total Planning. Give us a few minutes and we'll go ahead and get started. Okay, I see a couple more people coming in. Again, thank you for joining us. We'll go ahead and get started here in just a minute. If you do have any questions, feel free to put them in the question and answer box at the bottom, and we will try to answer as many as we can. And if we can't get to your question, then we'll reach out to you individually with your answer. Okay, I think we're right at 12 o'clock, so we're going to go ahead and get started here.
Thank you, Julie. Thank you for getting us all warmed up. And thank you to friends, clients, family. I'm seeing a lot of people signed up. We might just give it another like 10 to 15 seconds. We had a significant number of people sign up for today, and it feels like this is a topic that's on a lot of people's minds. So let me just do a quick sound check and a visual check. So Julie, do I look okay? Do I sound okay? And does the screen look okay from your end?
You look great. You sound great. And the screen looks perfect.
So in case you're wondering, Julie is on the payroll, which is why she's got to say that I look great. So thank you for that, Julie. All right. Well, listen, it is the middle of the day. It is a Friday and it's sunny outside here in New Jersey. So I'm not going to hold you guys up, but thank you again so much for joining us today. It is Friday, November 4th, I believe. It's the 4th, right? Yeah, it's the 4th. And today we're going to be talking about some fun stuff for Friday. My name again is Neil Shaw. I'm with Shaw Total Planning. I'll get into that a little bit, but we're going to be talking today about our economic market update for 2022, and we're going to talk about your proactive tax update. So without further ado, let's get right into it. Our agenda today, pretty straightforward. First, I'm going to share with you some stuff that's out of your control and make you feel bad. That's going to be the economic and the market update. We are going to talk about some tangible things that we should be thinking about with respect to what's happening with the markets right now, with your investments and with your money. But then I'm going to make you feel a little bit better, because we're going to talk about taxes, but we're not just going to talk about taxes. We're going to talk about proactive tax planning for 2022. And we're going to talk about some new key proposals that are basically making their way through Congress, see which of them might become law. And most importantly, what can you do about it? So with that being said, I mean, it's going to be a chock full of a lot of fun stuff. Now use the Q&A part of our feature. Like if you have questions, go ahead and post them in there. Julie's monitoring that. We're not going to take questions while we're actually doing the presentation bit because there's a lot that we want to get through, but we are going to do our best to get through it on the air. And if we don't get through your questions on the air, we'll make sure that we answer them afterwards. So kind of who we are, for those of us who know us, you'll see a lot of different companies there, but Shaw Total Planning is our umbrella company. That's the one that basically we use to brand ourselves, but our legal services are provided through Shaw & Associates. And our financial services are provided through Beacon Wealth Solutions. But yes, if people ask, Neil, are you a financial advisor or are you an attorney or are you a tax strategist? The answer is yes, we're all of it. And the idea is to provide this integrated service solution. I really like you. I do. I'm looking at the list of everybody that's on here. I really like all of you, but you may not be my client right now. But even if you are my client, in case you didn't know I was a lawyer already, this will definitely tell you that I'm a lawyer. But this is not legal advice. This is not tax advice. It's not financial advice for you specifically. It's meant for general purposes. It's not marital advice. It's not cooking advice. God knows I'm not in a position to give cooking advice. But the only way to start a relationship with an advisor, with an attorney, is to have an engagement letter. So just know this is general legal advice. Now, also know that when we finish here, the party doesn't have to end here. There's a bunch of different ways for us to get in touch and keep in touch. So for those of you who know, we have a website, we've got a Facebook page, we've got a YouTube channel. And in case that's not enough, this is a whole lot of Neil on the screen right now because you're probably seeing me multiple places, but we do have a weekly show. So if you follow us on Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn, or any of those channels, you will get at least weekly updates when breaking news occurs on the tax, legal, financial, investment, insurance space itself. So Shaw Planet airs on every Tuesday, and it's still available if you're following those social media pages, in case this isn't enough for me. And then there's also these sort of like news periodicals and stuff. I'm not going to get into that right now, too, in the interest of time. You will have, each of you will receive a follow-up email afterwards here, and you can also click on it afterwards. So take your notes while you're here. There's going to be a lot of action items here. And of course, you're not going to be able to do all of them because nobody's able to do all of them, but you might have questions about them. So don't hesitate to reach out to us, or you could send an email. You could do a phone call, smoke signals, courier pigeon, anything that really works here for you. So you'll be able to ask questions as you're kind of going through that panel too. Before we begin, it's important to remember there are five key areas of planning, in my opinion. So there's preservation planning, retirement planning, which is also income planning. There's tax planning, estate planning, and investment planning. We're a comprehensive integrated solution total planning firm. So we try to consider the impact of any recommendation that we make, not just on one, but across all areas. And that's why you're going to see, we're going to talk about market updates and investments today, but we're also going to be talking about tax planning today. So that's our focus. But it's impossible to talk about those things without also thinking about the estate planning implications and the repercussions of that too. So you'll see that this stuff doesn't always neatly fit into one of these categories because it is by its very definition all integrated. Knowledge is power. For those of you who used to watch your Saturday morning cartoons, you remember it's fun to learn because knowledge is power. Well, knowledge is kind of power. It's inert power for you physicists out there. We've got this knowledge, but it doesn't really do anything unless you actually do something with the knowledge. So let's start with building that knowledge today. And then let's remember everything is about action plans. And by the way, all the stuff that I share today with you, know that you can do it on your own. You might have another advisor. I see some friends that are on here that are also advisors too. So you might have an advisor who's helping you with this. If you don't, or if you want a second opinion, we are here to help with that too. So don't hesitate to reach out on that too. Now, as we look at this chart, as we get into sort of the financial piece of what's going on, you'll see that the S&P 500, the Standard & Poor's 500, which is really like 504 stocks, if you will, you'll see that as of November 3rd, we're still well above those pandemic-driven lows. But 2022 has been a volatile year. You'll see that the equity markets, they produce multiple ups and downs, but looking at year-to-date, pretty much all stock markets are down from 2022. Yes, I know most of us know that already, but good to level set here. So for that reason, and for any reason, we still want to maintain that long-term investing is still going to be your best strategy. You want to make sure that, so we're not changing anything here. We're not being reactive. And in fact, one of my clients has put it best is, look, when in doubt, zoom out. You'll see that this first year, the S&P 500 has been down, and from September 20, 2021 until September 2022. So that's yucky. You know, I think that's a technical term, yucky. Nobody likes that. But when we start looking at this five-year window, yeah, we're looking better. When we look at this 10-year window, it shows a nice gain as well too. 40-year window looks even better. So this is why if somebody said, look, Neil, I've got $100,000 and I want to make sure that I've invested it for that 1 year efficiently, this probably isn't going to be your best scenario. This isn't basically how you want to invest. But if you're looking at long-term investments and if you got a longer horizon, you can still be rewarded for the risk that you take. And I think that's important. Let's keep going. And I see that the questions are coming in. Keep the questions coming in on there. Once we finish, we'll try to attack as many of those as possible. And if we don't get to them on air, we will go back to them afterwards. There are a lot of factors that are affecting the movement of these stock markets and the equity markets. And there are four, I would say, major equity market concerns right now. We got this continuation of rising inflation rates. And I'm going to address what happened this week in a couple of minutes. We have further interest rate changes. We've got recession concerns, and we got this geopolitical unrest. So these things are going to be major factors in determining like the future market, future direction of how these markets are going to work. But let's talk about each one individually. In 2022, we've been experiencing these, I'm not going to say crazy, but it's the fastest rise of inflation since the 1980s. Obviously, that's a long time. The Federal Reserve, they've tried to slow down this runaway train, but the rate of inflation is still strong. It's still going pretty well. Now, will what the Federal Reserve is doing with the interest rates have an impact? Only time's going to tell, right? I can work out, you know, 5 days a week, but I'm not going to know generally at the end of that fifth day whether the workout's actually having effect. And the interest rate changes are going to be somewhat like that too. It's going to take a little while to see what the long-term impact is going to be. With September's year-over-year inflation rate being 8.2%. Yeah, that's right. You heard me right. 8.2%. So these policymakers, they still have a long battle ahead of them, trying to figure out how they're going to keep inflation, how they're going to get it to a more stable pace. I don't need to tell this to you. It's a real concern, not just for, you know, for Wall Street. It's a concern for Main Street. It eats into our purchasing power and our lifestyle. And right now we got important things. We got Black Friday coming up, right? We've got Cyber Monday. We've got the holidays coming up. How are we going to afford all of this stuff? I'm sure you've been experiencing the effects of inflation in some part of your life. The four major areas where I think Americans are seeing most of the pressure is the grocery store, the gas pump, the electric bill, housing costs. You know, so whether you're renting or whether you're buying, it's a good idea for investors to at least try to keep pace with inflation or exceed inflation rates. If the cost of everything is going up 8% and we got our money sitting in the stock market earning, you know, 1%, 2%, 3%, we're actually losing purchasing power. So we as advisors are for our clients keeping an eye on inflation and interest rates and any changes in how they're going to impact our clients. And there's also indirect impacts of there too, right? So when the Fed Reserve met this week, they had their recent meeting in November. They decided that they're going to raise their interest rates, and you'll start seeing again, you know, somewhere between 3.75 to 4%, excuse me, is the new interest rates. They have stood by their commitment to continue to combat this inflation. They're increased rates and increasing interest rates until they see inflation coming back down again to a reasonable growth rate. So what are we going to see now? In mid-December, the Fed Reserve is going to meet again. And a lot of analysts are expecting to see rate hikes again and factor that. Now, this information might be baked into the stock market. It may not be baked into the stock market. But when they met this past Wednesday, the Fed hinted that it might consider slowing the pace of inflation as well. Considering slowing the pace of the interest rate increases. So Chairman Powell has basically shared is that he is going to take into consideration what the cumulative impact of all of this tightening monetary policy is going to do. And it's not just about the inflation. They are looking at it from a more macro, a big picture perspective. What does that mean? Well, the central bank is going to stay the course until the job is done. It's premature. I don't think they could talk about, and he's used the word very premature about whether he's going to stop these interest rate hikes right now too. So what does that mean? It means be cautious. All that being said, interest rates ran high in the 70s and the 80s. This is not the first time we're seeing this, right? It's been going on. And you can see on this chart right here that we're still nowhere near those highs. So here's the thing. It's like my kids have summer vacation or they have winter break coming up right now. Now, I have one in college and one is applying to colleges, so I really don't have this anymore. But when they were younger, you would let them stay up past a certain bedtime. And it's like anarchy, right? When the summer hits, they're staying up till 11, 12, God knows how long. And then all of a sudden, Labor Day rolls around in the Northeast and school's starting. And now you have to get them used to start waking up early again. Well, during the 2010s, we got very comfortable with the federal funds rate being at or near zero. That was us staying up late. That was us getting used to a certain lifestyle. But now the Fed funds rate, which influences all these other interest rates, it's becoming a concern again. Time to go back to school. So although we've been through this cycle before, it's been a long time, and it does mean that we've got to adjust. We've got to pivot here. So what's the good news about this? Well, treasury yields, they're actually doing well in this environment. And I get a lot of calls about I bonds and certain fixed investments because interest rates, partially because of interest rates being a little more favorable here. So this chart is actually showing that significant increase in yields that we've had so far in 2002 across the 5, 10, 20, and 30-year timeframes. As of November 2nd, 5-year notes, they're yielding 4.3%, 10-year notes yielding 4.1%, and so on and so forth. So what does this all mean? If you want to find out how bonds or bond funds or other fixed income things should work into your retirement income strategy, give us a call. That being said, it hasn't all been rosy, right? So periodically, you're going to find times when stocks and bonds are down together. We kind of went through this, right? Bond investing can be tricky, and there's also certain tax implications. And then you want asset location, make sure that it's held in the right place. So you want to make sure you're taking advantage of not just the favorable bond yields, but the tax impact of that. It could be brief, it could be long-term. If you want to take advantage of those, if you're not already conscious of that, certainly let us know. We are monitoring how the Fed movements and the interest rates are affecting these bond yields, because for a lot of our clients, it's a significant part of their portfolio. We want to make sure we're being intentional about how things are actually being held there. There is a lot of talk about recession, and we're not just talking about hairlines here. Empirically, we are in recession territory. But unlike many severe recessions that the economy and jobs, they're not in terrible shape. Like when we've had severe recessions in the past, the economy and the jobs have been in bad shape. So therefore, a lot of analysts are citing that maybe another Great Depression is not on the radar. You know, maybe this is more of an economic cyclical thing, but we're not necessarily talking about a Great Depression type thing, which is always good news, right? Generally, Great Depressions are bad. So we generally want to try to avoid those too. Geopolitical unrest. Look, there's still Russia and the Ukraine, and there's concerns about conflict with China and Taiwan and these sort of trade implications that happen with geopolitical unrest. And then what's Kanye going to do next? And no, I'm kidding. Nobody cares about Kanye. Well, a lot of people care about Kanye, but we don't care about Kanye. But there's going to be some impact of this geopolitical unrest and how things are going to play out over time. How do we make sure that our portfolios are being insulated or at least somewhat diversified across this too? So we want to keep a watchful eye on it. Don't want to be reactive to it. Now, here's something that's interesting. You know, news, financial commentary, the talking heads, they can really influence the way people invest. But without a strong investment philosophy to guide them, people start following the advice of friends and neighbors and family. And I can't tell you how many of my conversations start with, you know, somebody told me to do X, or I just heard that I should be doing Y, or at a cocktail party or at a Diwali party or something like that. Especially if that insight promises a fast, easy return. I'm not saying you shouldn't listen. I'm just saying that maybe you want to let some of it go in one ear, not the other, because growing wealth has no shortcuts. Success requires a solid investment long-term approach. So what you're looking at on this chart right here is you're seeing since 1970, these things that have been going on in the world and how the market sort of kind of just ignored it and done its thing from a long-term perspective. You got everything from the Y2K scare here. Remember that? That was a thing, the Y2 scare. Back then, we had Business Week declaring in the late 70s the death of the equities. We had oil prices dropping down there. And recently, Hurricane Katrina and Hurricane Rita and the Iraq war beginning. But yet the market just kind of stood its course. One thing that I love to remind you is CNBC, Forbes. Yes, I'm actually naming names. Newsweek and Kiplinger's, all those magazines. Who do they owe a duty to? They owe a responsibility to their shareholders. They do not owe responsibility to you. They are not advisors. They are there to get clicks or to get eyes or to sell ads and make money for their shareholders and their investors. So that being said, they're not going to tell you things are going just great. You know, it's kind of like that news forecast right before the big snowstorm. You know, 10 inches of snow coming. Make sure you tune in at 6. If they told you everything's going to be fine, you're probably not tuning in. So just realize that they have an agenda and it may or may not be consistent and usually is not consistent with your own agenda. All right. There might be a little more preaching here, just kind of a heads up. We are in the business of providing proactive planning and preservation. So we're not trying to predict the highs and the lows. No one's got a crystal ball. But if we want to look at trends, and I'm not saying we should be driving our car forward looking in the rearview mirror, but it's good to know where we came from, right? Historically, the fourth quarter has actually been a good one from investors in the past. The last 70 years include some very difficult fourth quarters too. So I don't want to say that this is a universal thing, like including October of 1987. That was when the market collapsed. And that was actually obviously in the fourth quarter. So it had its single worst day in history, the fourth quarter. So when you're studying the last 70 years of returns, about 80% of the time, the fourth quarter has actually ended the respective year on a high note. I'm not saying it's going to happen. I'm not saying it's not going to happen. I'm just saying it has happened. So as we head into the year end, again, you want to keep a watchful eye in the market. I'm not saying this should change or deter your behavior, but if you're looking for something to say, hey, maybe things will work out okay for the fourth quarter, there it is. I love this quote by the Oracle of Omaha. The stock market is a device for transferring money from the impatient to the patient. If you follow me on social media, you know I just shared this recently. His partner, Charlie Munger, said, look, it's waiting that helps you as an investor. And a lot of people just can't stand to wait. It's not timing the market. It's time in the market that we need to be mindful of. And these guys have done it best. You know, figured you didn't want to just take my word for it. So one more time, as you can see again from another view, those investors who focus on the long term are historically rewarded with significant returns. While ups and downs, they're just part of the investment experience. That 40, 20, 10-year investment horizon that you're looking at right here, it's actually got sort of a steep path upward. You know, past performance is no promise of future performance. I get all of that too, but you know, it's kind of hard to refute what's happened in the past year too. So here's the thing. And this guy who's here, I love this image right here. As the Chicago Bears are getting ready to play the Miami Dolphins this Sunday, the Bears have traded away two of their best defensive players, and they gained one wide receiver who's just entering the playbook. The Miami Dolphins have been doing really well. When you're talking about sports betting, Vegas, Las Vegas actually puts out lines and they have an idea of what they're going to do. And the general consensus is, you know, if you assume that sports aren't fixed or anything like that, the general thinking is that Vegas knows what they're doing. They have these lines for a certain way. Now, think of the stock market as similar to that, as like Vegas, when they're putting out the odds. It's a large information processing machine that takes in all the available information from the company. All this information impacts the price of a stock as buyers and sellers transact. We think sometimes that we're going to get out ahead of people and we're going to get ahead of the market and actually pick a winner and a loser. But realize that if you own shares in one of these companies, you are part of an institutional investment vehicle. You own shares. 85% of the trades on the New York Stock Exchange are done by institutional investors, not individual companies. All these guys who are processing all this information, kind of like Vegas is when you're about to bet on a football game. And then from there, the price is actually baked in because the company's equity, its prospects, and all that stuff is kind of working in. I guess my point in bringing all that up is you're not guaranteed to be able to pick the winners and the losers. In fact, the odds are pretty stacked against you. And if anybody was able to pick the winners and the losers, it might be the folks who actually have access to that information on a regular basis. So it's kind of like when you're in traffic, and a lot of us are going to be driving around for Thanksgiving, and we're going to be trying to get to a certain place, and we might be late because we finished baking something kind of late or heating something up late, or we wanted to see the fourth quarter of the game that we were watching, that 12 o'clock game. So as we are trying to get to our place, we're kind of shifting into the right lane, and we get into the left lane, and we get into the right lane because we hit this traffic and we just want to keep moving forward. And as we see this one car that we've identified, and like, as long as I beat that guy, I'm in good shape. Most of the time it just causes anxiety because you're usually not beating that guy. So how many times have you been stuck in traffic and you switch to like the faster lane? As soon as you get into that lane, everything comes to a stop. And now you might be risking an accident because you're trying to squeeze in. You can't pick winners and losers. You can't predict the market itself. Just be long-term, leave a little earlier, right? That's where the planning comes in. I guess that's where the equivalent would be here too. So with that being said, picking winners and losers, sometimes the Facebooks, the Apples, the Netflix, the Amazons, and the Microsofts and the Googles of the world, we think that they're going to be fine. And most of the cases, yeah, you might be fine. But the kinds of companies that did extremely well in the 2010s and during COVID, during that market downturn, they, for the most part, underperformed the market since in 2022. So kind of goes back to that whole argument of diversification and not putting too many eggs in one basket, even if it's a really good basket. So what do? Is it time to get out? Do we jump? Well, here's the thing, and I get this call often, but not from our clients, because our clients have been pretty disciplined about this too. But the idea is, look, if you're going to choose to get out of the market, you're going to be sitting on cash. And if you're sitting on cash, you're not earning enough to keep up with inflation. So if the idea is, yeah, I'm going to get out now and I'm going to get back in when things are safe, remember, you got to be right twice. You got to get out at the right time and you got to get in at the right time. Because what happens is if you missed, you see the S&P 500 since 1990, if you just put $1,000 in right there, it's worth $26,000 now. If you missed the single best day, you go from a 10.76 to 10.38. Okay, not a big deal. But let's just say you missed the best 15 days. You missed the best week of the market, best 2 weeks of the market. Now you're talking about going from a 10.76% rate of return to a 7.15% rate of return. You had to be right twice. You had to get out of the market at the right time and get back into the market at the right time. And I don't know too many people who could do that. In fact, the world doesn't know too many people who could do that. So remember, discipline is the course itself. Now, when the market has dropped 20%, most often, but not always, I can't emphasize that enough, not always, but the market has tended to do well after there's been a 20% drawdown. It usually increases, I should say increases, but it has increased on average about 12% over the next year. We don't know when the best days are going to be. We don't know when the worst days are going to be, but just a little bit of sort of optimism, if you will. Make sure you vote. Can't say that enough. Make sure you vote. I know it's crazy season right now because everybody seems to hate everybody until the election's over and then hopefully things will peace out. But this shows the hypothetical portfolio, the wealth of an investor who put a dollar into the S&P 500 in 1926. It lays out the party control over time. And so you're seeing where it's purple, there's mixed control. Where it's blue, it's Democratic control. And where it's red, it's Republican control. Both parties have had periods of growth. And both parties have had periods of decline. So there doesn't really appear to be a pattern. So there's a lot of people who say, well, if the Republicans come in, it's going to be X, or if the Democrats come in, it's going to be Y. Not really. There's no way to actually know that. I mean, yes, policies might make a difference, but if you're going to bank on that, chances are, you know, based on past history here, there's really not a pattern of strong correlation there too. Now, 2022 has been a volatile year so far. So I am proceeding with this, I'm proceeding with caution. And I think that's my mantra for all of our clients as well. Proceed with caution. Keep watching all the areas of the economy. We're watching it for our clients. And just make sure that you kind of know what your individual circumstances is, right? Because usually there's not a good strategy or a bad strategy. It's just whether or not it's the right strategy for you. Here are four reminders that I'm asking for our investors before we shift into the tax planning portion of our webinar here too. What's your risk tolerance or appetite? How much risk are you willing to take? Or more appropriately, how much risk can you afford to take? What's your time horizon? How long do you want to be invested in a particular situation? How soon do you have to start cashing out and starting exit? Behavior is huge, right? People have heard me say, I don't have people with money problems. I've got money with people problems a lot of times. So market volatility, it's part of the investing experience, but it causes anxiety. It causes stress. When you see your 401k become a 201k, I get it. But how well can we emotionally endure the potential ups and downs of the investments? That's something that we need to keep in mind. And your overall strategy. And quite frankly, our main goal is to help you to stay focused on your strategy. And if it's something that you're not sure that you can tolerate, or you're not even sure if you're in the right place, give us a call, shoot us an email, use the link that Julie shares with you here, and you can actually use that to schedule time with us too. But yeah, overall strategy, you want to make sure that your overall strategy does quite fit where you want to be. Maybe the media is influencing you. Maybe the cocktail party is influencing you. Maybe these holidays are coming up and it's stressing you out because you don't want to talk about crypto right now. We want your holdings to be congruent with your overall strategy. Panic creates more risk and could potentially cause setbacks. So here are some key takeaways, again, before we shift into the tax part of it too. Caution is still the principal notion for investors. Inflation continues to be a catalyst for concern in rising interest rates. Interest rates look like they're going to continue to rise for the near future. We are in recession territory. Long-term investing is a key strategy with equity markets, but remember, we're always here to help you. Now, I promised you, I wasn't just going to make you feel bad. I was going to give you some action items. So we did that. Now let's talk about some more action items and what we can expect from a tax perspective. You know, this is a crazy thing, right? For somebody who's in a 24% tax bracket, we're talking about being excited about getting like a 8-10% rate of return. But if you save a tax dollar, that's like giving yourself a 24% rate of return. So let's shift into this sort of thing that we can control a little bit more, because quite frankly, taxes are a part of every investment. It blows my mind, when I hear that somebody's got a financial advisor, investment advisor, who's not reviewing tax returns twice a year. It's got to be done. We review tax returns for our clients multiple times throughout the year. And it's because we want to know what the tax impact is going to be before an investment strategy is implemented, before an investment strategy is put into place, or before a net transaction is done. Other than the annual IRS inflation adjustments, 2022 has brought a lot of talk about changes, but not a whole lot of changes. So some of the tax law provisions that were passed in bills like the Inflation Reduction Act, they affected corporations. Like it changed the corporate minimum tax of 15% to corporations, anybody over $1 billion. But while President Biden has suggested some personal income tax and estate planning tax changes are going to happen in 2022 in his budget and tax plans, a lot of experts are saying it's pretty unlikely that those changes are going to be approved and will take effect earlier than next year, if at all. So something to keep in mind. But let's start quickly distinguishing between the difference between tax planning and tax preparation. When the Bears are playing the Dolphins this weekend, you look up at the scoreboard and the game is over. That's tax filing. That's basically tax preparation. Score's done. You can't do anything about it. Game's over. Before the Bears play the Dolphins, figuring out that the Dolphins secondary is not really all that good and Justin Fields should throw the ball more, or they've got a strong run defense and we shouldn't run the ball as much, that is game strategy. That's tax planning. Tax planning is looking before year end, and that's why you're on this webinar right now, whereas tax preparation is more about filling out your tax forms at the year end and being compliant. Both are important, but there's a time for each. This workshop is about tax planning, not preparation. And it's about hearing some of these proactive ideas. So one of our founding forefathers, right? By failing to prepare, you are preparing to fail. So we're not preparing to fail and you guys are all here. So kudos. Now, what are you going to do about this? Let's get into that. So what do we need to know? In 2022, there are still 7 individual tax rates. What that basically means is you got that 10% all the way up to 37%. Under current law, this 7-rate structure, this actually kicked into effect in 2017 under President Trump's Tax Cuts and Jobs Act. It's scheduled to automatically phase out on January 1st, 2026. And at that point, we're going to relapse back to what the pre-2017 tax law was. Of course, unless Congress does something. The highest rate in that situation is going to be that 39.6. So we go back to that again. And let's just say that if there's planning to be done, this is the time to do it because there's this general feeling that taxes are not going to get much cheaper. There's this double whammy. By the way, these twins are from the movie The Shining. One of the scariest memories of my childhood was when my friend made us stay home from school and watch The Shining itself. I don't even know why I chose that picture. I should really just avoid that because I'm probably not going to sleep tonight. But here's the thing that you need to understand about this double whammy. When you're in mutual funds and the market is down, sometimes a lot of people leave the fund. And when people leave the fund, mutual fund managers have to raise cash. And when they raise cash, they're not going to sell off the stuff that's down. They're going to sell off the stuff that's up. And when they sell off the stuff that's up, they will distribute those capital gains. And you may have a taxable impact as a result of those capital gains distributions, even if you didn't actually get the cash. So what's the double whammy? The double whammy is come December 31st, you look at your statement and your funds are down, but then you look at your 1099 and your tax bill is high. So we are keeping an eye on this for our clients right now. Obviously, it's hard to do it because of timing considerations, but there are some factors within the advisor's control. You want to keep an eye on this because that is the insult to injury part of it too. Having significant negative returns on paper and then still having higher taxes. So if there's a way to avoid that, that's something you want to keep in mind. If you're not sure if that's something you'll be able to avoid, give us a buzz. The standard deduction for 2022, for those people who don't itemize, that's gone up. Those amounts are $12,950 and $25,900. Incidentally, if you're on our physical mailing list right now, we have sent out a tax report, which I think has a lot of the stuff summarized. I'm a big fan of it, quite frankly. I keep it as a cheat sheet. So if you want a copy of that, drop us a note, let Julie know. We will get that over to you. It is a paper copy. But I think it's one of my favorite mailing pieces because I geek out on that sort of stuff. Now, how should you view itemized deductions if you don't take the standardized deduction? Now, the old rule was we're going to try to accelerate or realize as many deductions and take them as soon as possible. But with those higher standard deductions, the new rule is you want to try to plan them carefully. You want to batch them together. An example, if I give $1,000 a year to charity, I may not be able to take that as a deduction because of the new rules with respect to deductions. But if I batch those deductions together and I put them into a receptacle where I can take a significant tax deduction this year and then I can slowly drip it out to the charity over 10 years, now I got the benefit of a tax deduction this year and I still got the same outcome I was looking for. So that's an example of batching those deductions together. You want to be mindful of that and you've got to look at the tax return in order for that. two of the more widespread deductions, and I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this because we've spoken about it in a past webinar before, but the state and local tax deduction, as well as the mortgage deduction. These are pretty significant here. So for mortgages taken after 1987 and before 2017, mortgage interest is fully deductible for the first $1 million of mortgage debt. But that threshold for the first $750,000 or $375,000 after 2017, obviously it got much lower. So for those of you with mortgages, check with your tax preparer on how much of an interest deduction you can take. And equally as important is, look, if you're not getting the benefit of that, and if there's alternative ways to help you out with that, then investigate what are different ways for me to get around that tax deduction piece. So in 2022, that SALT, state and local tax and deduction, it's still limited to $10,000. There's been some talk about some modifications there, but nothing that we've seen so far. In 2022, long-term capital gains, they're still getting a tax break. So we're kind of coming up on some of these year-end sort of tax moves itself too. So these are pretty self-explanatory on the rates itself. One thing that I think most taxpayers need to think about is tax gains and tax loss harvesting. What does that mean? Well, when we're talking about harvesting, we're talking about a strategy that has taxpayers selling assets that are at a loss to offset things that are at a gain. This tax strategy, it can be pretty valuable, and we've done it pretty key. But here's a fact that you need to keep in mind. You can use up to $3,000, $1,500 if you're a married couple filing separately, in capital loss above capital gains to offset that ordinary income. So you're doing this basically because you've got gains somewhere else and you want losses here. But remember, when you're taking a long-term gain for tax purposes, although that tax is paid at the lower rate, it's paid sooner. And there's a separate rule. You can't just do it today. You can't just, take a loss today and then buy that stock right back, because there is a wash sale rule that you need to be aware of. And if that ain't complicated enough, there's another set of rules that you need to know with respect to crypto, which actually might be a little bit more liberal. So if you don't have somebody who's looking at that for you, give us a call, talk to your tax planner, talk to your tax strategist itself, because this is the time when you can actually maximize some of these tax benefits. For those of you who are not fully retired yet, make sure you review your year-end retirement contribution planning, because we're expecting some changes on this, and I'll talk about this with the Secure Act 2.0. You can get a copy of the slide if you want to later, just let us know. But these are the retirement plan contribution limits for 2022, expected to be modified a bit for 2023. And if you got money in a pre-tax account, an IRA, a 401k, a 403b, or anything where you haven't paid the taxes yet, start investigating whether it makes sense to do a partial or a full Roth IRA conversion. We've done some of these for our clients. And it's important because we talked right now about how tax rates are as low as they've been, quite frankly. And if the idea is these tax rates are going to go up and we're going to have to pay taxes on some of these funds anyway, might as well choose your tax rate, right? We could use these to lower your overall taxable income long-term. These Roth IRAs, they have tax-free compounding. They would have no RMDs. They allow for tax-free withdrawals. The hitch is you'd have to pay the taxes right now. So it may or may not make sense for everybody, but I think it's a conversation that everybody has to have. And you want to know what the ripple effect of that's going to be. By having that much income, is it going to change my Medicare surtax? By having that much income, is it going to knock me out of sort of other tax benefits that I might be getting, or other subsidies that I might be getting because I have more income? But if you have a RMD requirement, or if you have a pending RMD required minimum distribution requirement, give us a call, because this is the kind of time where you could do this sort of planning. Like all planning, it's always better when it's done sooner than later. As a result of the recently passed Secure Act, overall family tax bracket management, that's a critical area. Now, what I mean when I say family tax bracket management is you might be in a certain tax bracket, but you might have beneficiaries or next of kin that are in either a higher tax bracket or a lower tax bracket. Who's in the best position to realize income at the best tax bracket? Can we choose, look at the entire family and see who's in a better position to take income versus not taking income? This is what I mean by looking at family tax brackets. I've got a daughter in college. I've got another one who's applying. They might still fall under my tax return. 4 or 5 years from now, they might not. But they might still not have the same level of income that I have. Or I might have elderly parents that are in a lower tax bracket. So there's a lot of sort of considerations there. But it's not just about the two people who are in the room or are signing the tax return. You want to look at the overall family tax bracket. And of course, it's got to be consistent with what it is you're trying to accomplish. So what is that marginal tax bracket for you? What is that marginal tax bracket for your beneficiaries? And who's better off? I won't spend a lot of time on qualified tuition plans because FAFSA is pretty much how I'm going to be spending my entire weekend because, you know, hashtag college dad life. But yeah, so I'll be spending time on that too. But just know that 529 planning is still very much alive and well, and it's become a little more liberal. Like unlike IRAs, there are no annual contribution limits for 529 plans, just really the gift tax rules itself that we need to be conscious of. But there's also the option to make larger 529 plan contributions. Like you can batch a lot of these together. If you're a parent or a grandparent and you're considering 529 planning, I think we could probably spend a significant time on a webinar just on this. But just know that that's something that you want to keep an eye on. You are still allowed to make gifts. And I've got a video about my grandmother, which was just referenced recently, about how this annual gift works. If anybody wants a link to that video, let us know. We'll get that over to you. It's on our YouTube channel. Just look for the video of me with a pair of jeans draped around my neck itself. But you're still allowed to gift annually. It's $1,000 more. You're actually allowed to gift $16,000 a year to as many people as you want. Your children, your grandchildren, your spouse, your lawyer, your financial advisor, anybody you really want to. You can give $16,000 a year without having to file any gift tax returns. You go over that, you'll have to file gift tax returns, but there are opportunities to make unlimited tax-free gifts if you're paying to the service providers directly, like if you're paying directly to a college, if you're paying directly to a medical expense provider. So you can make those directly and you're not limited to those same $16,000 rules. Now, it's still cheap to die, federally speaking. So you're still allowed to die with a lot of money in federal terms, I should say. So each spouse for a married couple is allowed to have $12.06 million before they pass away, when they pass away, I should say. And there would be no federal estate tax, $24.12 million each, effective 2022. Scheduled to go up and adjusted for inflation in 2023. However, anything on the excess of that is scheduled to be taxed at 40%. So you die with more than 12 million, your kids are going to pay 40% on that. Your spouse will not. In 2026, when this tax law expires, that's scheduled to go down to 5.6 million. What do we use for calculation purposes? Business interests, retirement accounts, life insurance, if you own the property, life insurance in your individual name, checking accounts, savings accounts, brokerage accounts, international assets, it all counts. So if there is an estate that's taxable here, and we deal with a lot of those, certainly give us a call because there are strategies you want to use before the clock strikes midnight on 2025, December 2025. Coming up on the end here, qualified charitable distributions. If you have RMDs, you want to make sure you're taking advantage of this before year end, where you might be able to send your money to the charity directly from your IRA. And by doing so, you will satisfy your required minimum distribution requirements, but you won't have to pay the income tax on that. And you won't have to even itemize your deduction, right? So one of the ideas we like very much is using these QCDs. And we've had many clients take advantage of these. So if you're not sure whether these are right for you, believe it or not, your RMD start at 72, but these qualified charitable distributions can actually start at 70 and a half. So there's a little bit of a discrepancy there too. If you're charitably inclined and you have an IRA, this has to be on the table with respect to conversations that you have. All right. And I know we're coming up late on time, so I'm going to keep going. All right. Let's talk about the recent proposals that are released that were released back in March of 2022. We call these the Green Book proposals. And the Green Book basically, it summarizes the administration's tax proposals contained in the budget. You know, please note, anytime there's these sort of legislation, I try not to talk too much about pending legislation because we don't know what's going to actually happen, how it changes before, but it definitely gives us an idea of where the government is actually thinking, right? Those of you who are business owners and pay corporate taxes, the Biden administration has proposed to increase the corporate tax by 7%, bringing it up to 28%. So that's kind of a thing. There's also a proposed billionaire minimum tax, which they're identifying as a 20% minimum tax on individuals who have more than 100 million in assets. Might not be relevant to everybody on the webinar, but it might be. So the other thing to kind of keep in mind, America loves a sequel, right? I can't wait for Avatar 2 to come out. I'm a big Avengers fan. I pretty much consume anything that's through Marvel. What's another sequel that we have going on? Secure Act 2.0. Again, we'll see what actually happens with it from a legal perspective. But some of the things that people are expecting in this Secure Act 2.0 is it might push RMDs back, 75 maybe? It might make it easier to buy annuities. It makes it offers extra assistance to student loan borrowers. It raises catch-up limits for retirement. So it's meant, SECURE literally stands for, let's see if I get this right, setting every community up for retirement, something, something, something. So basically, it's meant to be geared towards retirement planning itself. We'll see what actually happens there, but it's worth keeping an eye on. And if it looks like it's something that's going to happen mid-year, then maybe we hold off on taking out RMDs if you don't need them. So it's something to definitely keep on our radar itself, right? So here's a summary checklist of what we've got going on. And it looks like we're coming up on end here too at 12:45. So I might go a few minutes over, but hopefully I'll make it worth your while. Here's a summary checklist. This is available if any of you want, just let us know. It's in our tax report that Julie can send over to you. And if you need help with any of this, obviously let me know. But if I'm in your shoes, what I'm asking myself is, what's my anticipated tax bracket? Will I take standard or itemized deductions for timing purposes? Should I be considering capital gains or capital loss harvesting? What are my retirement planning contributions? What are my education planning opportunities, either for myself, my grandchildren, my nieces, my nephews, my children? What charitable planning am I considering doing? It doesn't have to be a lot. It's just got to be intentional. And what about the estate tax planning, right? And when you take all that into consideration, when you step back from this sort of tactics and the strategies, bigger picture is like, what are my major financial and life events that I'm expecting next year? Am I buying a home? Am I buying a second home? Am I moving states? Am I moving in with a child? Is a child moving in with me? All those considerations are super relevant. And a couple more things before I kind of get to the question. So what can you expect from us? Again, we are an integrated solution. We handle our estate plans in-house. We handle our investment management and our tax strategies in-house. So what you can expect from us is regular review of all of those things. Retirement planning. You can expect regular communication, more frequent conversations. You can expect basically that integrated advice. And remember, it's not just one-on-one, but that is what our clients get. But if you are interested in having sort of that one-on-one conversation, there's a box on our website that you can check. And that is basically that little box that's floating right there too. That will be the same thing that gets us to the link from shopland.com to actually schedule your one-to-one meeting. But if you haven't already followed us on Facebook or LinkedIn or YouTube, you will get updates by registering on the and kind of following our page, because every week, if you're not sick of me yet, you will get sick of me at some point. But if you're not sick of me yet, for 10 minutes on every Tuesday morning from 8:45 to 8:55, we run Shop Planet. And Shop Planet is our podcast, our video cast, where we will update you on things that are happening in the financial planning, investment management, estate planning, retirement planning space, everything that we sort of focus on too. So with that being said, you can absolutely call to schedule your call if you want to. You can find us on our website and boom, it's 12:46. I went 1 minute over. So I hope you guys will all take me up on this. I owe you all 1 minute. Jules, Julie, we have a couple of minutes left, and why don't we just kind of stay on, see if there, what questions we might be able to answer for anybody who's here. I've got them on here, Julie. Do you mind if I just kind of go at the questions?
Go for it.
All right. Thank you so much. So what is the major criteria for Roth conversions from IRA? There's a lot in there, and we actually have a special newsletter that talks just about that. So thank you for asking that question. Essentially, when you have that IRA, it's pre-tax money. Moving it to a Roth conversion, a big consideration is going to be the taxable impact of it too. So are you in a better tax bracket now than you're going to be in the future? And what is the impact of those required minimum distributions going to do for you? At some point, do you think you're going to do something with that Roth IRA that might involve you liquidating the whole thing in the future? And a huge one is, if I've got children who are going to be inheriting this IRA, are they in a higher bracket? Because under the Secure Act that passed in 2019, I want to say, when children or anybody other than a spouse, except for some exceptions, inherits this IRA, they're going to be required to take everything out within 10 years and pay taxes at their rate. So you got two kids who are doing really well financially, and they're going to be the ones who inherit the IRA, but yet you have limited income. it might make sense for you to realize that income as opposed to the kids realizing it. So a lot of different considerations. You might have some other things like losing the property tax freeze if you're a senior, or you know, something else that your impact trickles on. So those are all considerations there too. I'll tell you what, I see a lot of questions in here. I'll take a couple more and then we'll wrap it up. And anybody who didn't get their question answered, you have my word. We will actually get back to you on this too. My stronghold is my IRA, formerly 401k. Should I consider gifting some of the funds to my sons at this time? Well, I think I sort of answered that same question, is like, realize that if you gift it, you're paying the taxes right now. It might cease to be an IRA, but you want to make sure that your individual tax situation isn't going to be knocked off. You want to see who's in a better tax bracket itself too. If my house was put into a living trust and the application of my anchor. So the anchor benefit itself is probably a little bit more of an esoteric question. So I would probably ask, if it came in from an anonymous attendee. So if you want to ask us that question privately, we can certainly try to give you an answer on that too. For those of you who are not familiar, New Jersey anchor benefit is something what used to be called the homestead benefit. And there's some nuances with respect to when the property is in trust. Generally speaking, you should still be able to get it. And the last question, let's see if we could take this. How much should one be concerned about Social Security payments as far as preparation of one's tax returns are concerned? In a word, it's important. Depending on your income level, either 50% or 85% of your income is going to be, your Social Security income is going to be taxed. So it does depend on your other income sources and your total income sources itself, but it is a consideration. And I would say from a financial planning and a retirement planning perspective, you specifically want to know when's the right time to take that Social Security. And you want to make sure, if you don't have a strength in sort of that analysis, get somebody who can actually help you with that too. But taxes are going to be a consideration. Whether you need the money is going to be a consideration. What you're going to do with that money is a consideration as well too. So on that note, thank you for everybody who's joined us today. Some people have asked whether the recording is going to be available. We can make the recording available. Just drop us a note and let us know that you want that recording. And in the future, if you want any topics or anything like that covered, do let us know. I love hearing from the community itself. I hope you stay safe. I hope you stay well. And for the upcoming holiday season, I hope you're spending it with loved ones and staying healthy. Everybody have a fantastic weekend, and I'm looking forward to seeing everybody soon. Have a great day. Bye now.